Good morning, children. Today I am going to explain about the physical features of India, part 3. In today's physical features of India, part 3, I am going to explain about the Eastern Ghats, Western Ghats, Great Indian Desert, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and Lakshadweep Islands. Western Ghats are on the western, southwestern part of India. They lie along the Arabian Sea, stretch from the Tapi River to Kanyakumari in the south. Western Ghats are known by different local names such as Sahyadri in Maharashtra and Karnataka, the Nilgiris in Tamil Nadu, and Annamalai and Cardamom Hills along the Kerala and Tamil Nadu border. The average elevation is 900 to 1600 meters. These ghats are continuous and can be crossed through passes only. Example, Thal in the Thane district of Maharashtra, Bhor in Khandala, and Pal Ghat in Kerala region. They influence monsoons, the southwest monsoons. They are the source of many large rivers. The highest peak is Anaimudi with 2,695 meters and Doda Beta 2,637 meters. The average width is 50 to 80 kilometers. The six states covered by these Western Ghats are Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. Is it clear? Eastern Ghats, they lie on the southeastern part of India. They lie along the Bay of Bengal, stretches from Mahanadi Valley to the Nilgiris in the south. Eastern Ghats are known by different local names such as Malia and Mudugulakonda ranges in the north, Velikonda in Andhra Pradesh, and Kulimalai and Shavarai Hills in Tamil Nadu. The average height is 600 meters. Width varies from 100 to 200 kilometers. The highest peak of Eastern Ghats, Mahendragiri, 1,501 meters height. These ghats are discontinuous and irregular and dissected by rivers draining into the Bay of Bengal. No major rivers originated from the Eastern Ghats. The states covered by the Eastern Ghats are Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and some parts of Karnataka. I explained about Western Ghats and Eastern Ghats. Now we will see the differences between Western Ghats and Eastern Ghats. Observe carefully. Western Ghats are situated and mark the western edges of the Deccan Plateau parallel to the western coast of India along the Arabian Sea. Eastern Ghats are situated and mark on the eastern edges of the Deccan Plateau parallel to the eastern coast of India along the Bay of Bengal. Western Ghats, they are continuous, can be crossed through passes only. Eastern Ghats are discontinuous, irregular, and dissected by rivers draining into the Bay of Bengal. The average elevation is 900 to 1600 meters in the Western Ghats. The average height in the Eastern Ghats is around 600 meters. The height increases progressively from the north to south. The highest peaks are Anaimudi and Doda Belt. The Eastern Ghats, the highest peaks include Mahendragiri and Javadi Hills. Western Ghats encloses a narrow strip between the western slopes and the Arabian Sea, which is known as Western Coastal Plain. The maximum width is 64 kilometers. The Eastern Ghats also encloses a strip of land between the eastern slopes and the Bay of Bengal. That is the eastern coastal plain. The maximum breadth is 120 kilometers. The Western Ghats experiences orographic rain mostly in the summer due to the summer monsoon, that is southwest monsoons. So the climate is hot and moist. Coming to the eastern ghats, it receives rain both in summer and winter, especially in winter through the winter monsoons, that is the retreating monsoons. They touch to the Tamil Nadu coast in the month of December. However, here the rain is less than the western strip. Is it clear the differences between the western ghats and the eastern ghats? Now, Great Indian Desert, that is the Thar Desert. The Indian Desert lies toward the west margins of the Aravalli Range, receives very low rainfall, below 150 millimeters per year. Luni is the only large river in this region. I'll explain about this in the next slide. It has arid climate with low vegetation cover. It is an undulating sandy plain covered with sand dunes. Birchens cover large areas. The crescent shaped sand dunes, call them as birchens, you will find in the larger areas. These are the Thar Desert towards the western part of India. Great Indian Desert, Luni River. Though we are calling here desert, but one side we are saying about Luni River. Now we will see the important features of Luni River. Luni, which means saline in Rajasthan. The Indian river with the saline water that does not drain into any sea or ocean. If you see, almost all the rivers, they merge into either sea or ocean, but Luni is the only one river which will not drain into any sea or ocean. It runs a total course of approximately 495 kilometers. Though the river is called Sabarmati near its origin, it is called Luni later because the water turns saline from the salt content of the surface it flows on. Luni originates from the Naga Hills of the Aravalli Range in Rajasthan's Ajmer district from a height of 772 meters. Luni flows into the Thar Desert and meets its end in Bareilly, located at the northeastern part of the marsh called the Ran of Kutch in Gujarat, without flowing into any large water body. Children, if you see, the Narmada and the Tapi, they merge into the Arabian Sea, whereas Brahmaputra, Ganga, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, almost all these rivers, they merge into Bay of Bengal. Whereas Luni is the only one river which will not reach to either sea or ocean. Is it clear? Island groups of India. Now, the southern side of India, we have two island groups. One is Lakshadweep Islands and Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Island groups of India, Andaman and Nicobar, they are bigger in size and are more numerous and scattered. The elongated chain of islands located in the Bay of Bengal, extending from the north to south. These are Andaman and Nicobar Islands. The entire group of islands divided into two broad categories. One is Andaman in the north and Nicobar in the south. Port Blair is the capital of Andaman and Nicobar. It is believed that these islands are elevated portions of submarine mountains. These island groups are of great strategic importance for the country. There is a great diversity of flora and fauna in this group of islands. These islands lie close to the equator and experiences equatorial climate and has thick forest cover. The Andaman and Nicobars are separated by a channel around 150 kilometers wide. Coming to the island group of India, Andaman and Nicobar, one more important point is about the barren island. India's only active volcano is found on barren island in Andaman and Nicobar group of islands. The island groups of India, Lakshadweep Islands. Lakshadweep Islands, these are 36 coral islands that constitute Lakshadweep Islands. Only 10 are inhabited and only 6 have been opened for tourism. Their total land area is 32 square kilometers. These islands formed of coral deposits, they are called atolls. Atolls are circular or horseshoe shaped coral reefs. These are very close to the Malabar coast of Kerala, and Kavaratti is the island, the administrative headquarters of Lakshadweep Islands. These island groups have a great diversity of flora and fauna. The Pitti Island, which is uninhabited, has a bird sanctuary. Now, Lakshadweep Islands, the coral reefs, how they appear. The coral reefs is an underwater ecosystem characterized by reef building corals. Reefs are formed of colonies. Coral polyps are held together by calcium carbonate. The major reef formation in India are restricted to the Gulf of Mannar, Park Bay, Gulf of Kutch, Andaman and Nicobar Islands and the Lakshadweep Islands. Most coral reefs are built from stony corals whose polyps cluster in groups. The polyps are roughly cylindrical in shape and elongated at the axis of the S-shaped body. Clear? The physiographic divisions of India are complementary to each other. How they are complementary to each other, we will see now. So these are the physiographic divisions which I explained. The Northern Mountain Wall, Northern Plains, Great Indian Desert, the Peninsular Plateau, Western Coastal Plain and Western Ghats, Eastern Coastal Plain and Eastern Ghats, Lakshadweep Islands and Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now we'll see how they are complementary to each other. The mountains are the major source of water and forest wealth. Yes, the Himalayas, these are the major source for all the perennial rivers. So it is a major source of water. The origin of the rivers are from the Himalayas. The Northern Plains are the granaries of the country. They provide the base for early civilization. Northern Plains, they are the granaries of the country because of the water resources. The plains, they are very fertile lands. So fertile lands suitable for growing different crops. Next, the plateau, it is a storehouse of minerals which has played a crucial role in the industrialization of the country. It is a storehouse. If you see Chota Nagpur plateau, we call it as a storehouse of minerals. So most of the industries you will find in this belt. Next, the coastal region and island groups provide sites for fishing and port activities. The coastal plains, either the western coast, eastern coast or the island groups, Lakshadweep and Andaman and Nicobar Islands, they are provide sites for fishing and port activities. Port activities, that is import and export activities. Is it clear? Thank you, children. All the best.